What's up, guys? Welcome back to the channel. Today we're talking about how to pass a runner when you're running either on the trail, on a path, anyway, whenever you're coming up to another runner, how do you safely get past them? This is also my weekly running and training vlog, where the main purpose is for you to tell me about your week of running. I want to hear about your successes and I want to hear about your setbacks. And I know a lot of you raced last weekend. The Chicago Marathon was on Sunday. So I definitely want to hear about that. If you ran the Chicago Marathon, in fact, if you ran any race, let me know how it went in the comments below. All right, passing other runners, how to do it safely without being annoying. That's what we're talking about. Let's start off with when you are facing another runner. So there is another runner coming at you on the path. We're going to default to where you live and what side of the road you generally drive on. Obviously in the UK, we drive on the left and we pass on the right. Here in the US, we drive on the right and we pass on the left. So take that as your running cue. Now there are a lot of times when you have to kind of play chicken. You might come across a runner that is running down the path towards you and they're on the wrong side of the path. What do you do? Well, most of the time I'm going to stick to my guns and I'm going to stick to the right side of the path. I'm going to stick to the right side of the trail and hopefully they realize their error and move over to their right side if you're in the US, left if you're in the UK. And I'd say that 99% of the time this actually works, but you have to have a contingency plan. You've got to stay on your toes and be ready to pivot. What happens if they're just not paying attention? What happens if they don't see you? What happens if they do see you, but they're more committed to running on that side of the path than you are? Ultimately, it really doesn't matter. Just move over, go around them. Or, consequently, you could wait until you are face to face with them. Both have to awkwardly stop, say, excuse me, sorry. In that case, yes, you did have to break your pace. You did have to break your stride, but you can be confident in the knowledge that you are in the right. You are on the right side of the path. Okay, but you know, I'll be honest, that really doesn't happen that often. Most of the time where we run into trouble is when we are running and someone is in front of us and they're going in the same direction as us. So I wanna know, what do you do? How do you call out to them? How do you announce yourself? Now, of course, there's the old on your left or on your right, depending on which way you're passing. And I have to say that is probably my go-to most of the time. But you have to be prepared for the other person's reaction. Because you know what, it's gonna happen. I'm sure you've seen it. You say on your left and the person panics for a second and then steps to their left, right into your path. And if that happens, again, you just have to be able to pivot. You were going to the left, now you're going to the right. Remember, these other people that we come across on the trail, they're just like wild animals. We can't really predict what they're gonna do. We're only in control of ourselves. If it doesn't immediately go to plan, you change the plan. But here's the thing, there is an appropriate time to say on your left. And that appropriateness of time where you say on your left gets less and less and less the closer you get. If this person in front of you has no idea that you're creeping up behind them, by creeping, I mean running, you are probably going to scare them if you wait until you're 5 feet behind them before you say on your left. So I would suggest trying to announce yourself pretty far back from them. Give them time to react. Give them time to do the right thing. Perhaps they are one of the people out there that has to remember which is their left and which is their right. If you are one of those people, let me know in the comments below. But again, it doesn't always go to plan. Sometimes it's windy. Sometimes they're listening to music. Sometimes they're chatting with a friend and they're just not paying attention to what's coming up behind them. In that case, you may have to make several announcements. But let's say you don't want to greet the person that you're coming up on. You don't want to say on your left or on your right. Maybe you're running too hard and it's just too much work to get those words out. There are other non-verbal cues of getting your message across. The message that, hey, I'm quickly approaching, move over. And if you are pushing yourself, perhaps you're breathing heavy. Perhaps that heavy breathing is so loud that they know you're coming. Maybe you just cough a little. I know that when I am pushing the pace for a long time, I tend to kind of cough a little more than I do when I'm running easy. But it may not come naturally because you might not be running that fast. So you may have to fake a cough and that's okay. Actually, thinking about it, in today's day and age, it's probably going to make them jump out of their skin a lot more because of the whole COVID thing. If I heard someone coming up behind me coughing, better believe I would get out of their way. Another non-verbal option for letting a runner know that you're coming up behind them is to create the illusion that you're some kind of gangly, foot-dragging runner and kind of scuff your feet as you're coming up behind them. That sound may not be as scary as actually hearing a voice. And then they'll turn around, they'll see you, and they'll stand to the side and graciously bid you good day as you continue on your run. So, we've got the words, we've got the cough, we've got the scuff. If you are listening to music on the run, maybe you see them coming and you start kind of singing to yourself. That way, as you get closer, they will gradually hear the sound getting closer and closer. They won't be startled because you started singing to yourself so much further back. And you can just run by them, safe in the knowledge that you are enjoying your run and they think you're nuts for singing on your own. The previous things kind of assume that there isn't a lot of space. You've only got the two lanes of traffic on the path or the trail. If, however, you have a lot of room, I definitely choose the way of giving the person that's in front of me a very wide berth. So if it's a path on the road, I will make sure that there's no cars coming and I will run out onto the road, give that person a wide berth before cutting back in front of them a little bit further down. This is especially the case if someone is walking with a dog and maybe that dog will hear you first and maybe start to make a turn to run after you. I want to be far enough away where that dog can't reach me at the end of the leash. What happens if you're coming up on a runner and you're running just a little bit faster than them? This can get pretty awkward, especially if your speeds sort of matched. I would suggest before you get close enough where it's actually awkward that you're running that close to someone that you don't know, that you sort of make a break for it. You pick up your pace and you just come around them. Now you're still gonna give them the foot scrape, the deep breathing, the on your left, the on your right. Well, maybe call it on the deep breathing this time. You know what, now I'm thinking about it, the deep breathing just sounds super sketchy. I'm not gonna edit it out, but just forget the deep breathing. So I want you to pick up the pace. I want you to pick up the pace and get around them. But listen, guys, I want you to hold that pace. We've all been in races where there is someone that is using you as like a rabbit and they will speed up. They'll speed up and pass you, and then they'll cut in front of you and slow right down. My friends, there is nothing worse than that. Don't be that person. If you are gonna pass someone, if you're gonna pass another runner on the trail, on the road, gotta be committed, gotta get past them as quick as you can. And then you can pull back that speed because you just use that booster speed to get past them. But don't then slow back down to their pace so then they are the creepy one running on your heels. You gotta keep up your pace so you are moving away from them actively. Okay, I just wanna go back because I did just think of another thing that you could do in order to let someone know that you're creeping up on them. Most of us nowadays, at least I hope most of us, when we're running out there to be safe, we have our phones with us. Maybe you're listening to music, you got the headphones on, could just pretend to be on the phone. You know, we've seen these people talking to themselves walking down the street. I know I've been that person, maybe you have too. Pretend you're doing that on the trail, pretend you're doing that on the road. Just spark up a conversation, and I'll leave that conversation up to you for whoever you want to have it with and what you want to talk about. But that's half the fun of it, deciding on your fake conversation while you're trying to pass a runner. Right, the only side to faking a conversation while you're on the run is that you really have to be running at an easy pace. Now we all know that we're supposed to run most of our runs at an easy pace, which is a conversational pace. So if you are running at that pace, faking a conversation on your phone shouldn't be that difficult. If you're not running at an easy pace, maybe you're pushing it a bit too hard, it can be a bit of a challenge to put on that conversation for the sake of somebody else. You might think of a better way to announce yourself moving forward. And that's where the cough, and that's where the foot scrape, that's where that comes in. So I've had to put these things in order of my preference of how to announce myself when I'm coming through to another runner. I'm gonna say, on your left or on your right is at the top of the list, followed by a good foot scuffing, making them think that I'm just some rambling old runner coming through. Then it's gonna be singing, I suppose, followed by faking a conversation, and at the very bottom, deep breathing. Let's leave that for last. I suppose I have left the most simple thing to do for the very last thing, and that is to just have a normal conversation. If you're just out running on the path or you're out running on the trails, it's not absolutely necessary that you maintain a blistering pace. You could slow down just a little bit and have a normal conversation with the person in front of you. Excuse me, I didn't want to bother you, I'm just going to creep by on your left. That ongoing conversation, that longer than just a couple of words on your left, is going to put them at ease. It'll give them time to realize that you're talking to them, turn around and see you, and hopefully just move out of your way so you can go on by. Then you can pick the pace back up. In fact, now I think about it, that should probably go to the top of the list. And then it'll be just a quick on your left. All right, guys, let me know what you do. What do you do when you come upon a runner? Oh, you know what? One more thing. When you're in a race. Now, on road races, it's a little different because usually we have an entire road to pass people. It's quite easy to get around people. Where I run into trouble is on trails. So sometimes we'll be doing a trail race and it's a nice little single track. Wow, you're gonna have such a good time blasting through those small, thin trails. But you have a runner in front of you that is not running at your pace and you wanna get by them. And you can try the old on your left. But if it's a single track and there's no place for that runner to go, my friends, you cannot expect that runner to move over so you don't have to drop your pace, because they would have to drop their pace in order to do it. That's not fair. When we're racing, all things are off the table. That person in front of you, they got a better start off the line than you did. They deserve that spot in front of you. Now, you also deserve to get past them, but you have to find a way to do it. So wait for a little clearing, wait for an area where the trail gets a little wider, and then blast them. And just remember that. Now, some people are gonna get pretty annoyed when you're racing and the slower person is in front of them. Do not be a grumpy runner. No one likes a grumpy runner. Just try and get by them. What do they say in NASCAR? If you ain't rubbing, you ain't racing. All right, guys, well, listen, I had a good week. I had a good week of running. Now, this is definitely a down week compared with my week last week, but still pretty solid training week. And I'm starting to develop my plans for the future. I do have some races that I'm looking forward to. I will announce those in later videos. But last week, my week started off with 7.6 miles. Now I did run over to the mall where I did the UTC Hills. UTC is just the name of the mall. It's the University Town Center. And I just ran up and down the car park. I wasn't breaking any records. I just wanted to go out and I wanted to get a little elevation gain. I wanted to do an easy run, but I wanted to do some climbing at the same time. Now, I use that term climbing very lightly, but technically speaking, the top of the hill is higher than the bottom of the hill, so it is climbing. Tuesday was a workout day. I knocked out 8 miles, but I also included 6 800s with 400 recovery in between each of the 800s. And I felt pretty good about that. Still pretty toasty here in Florida, so I am super excited about the temperatures coming down and maybe being able to take the speed up a little bit. Wednesday was a super cruisy 10 miles. I just wanted to get some nice and easy miles in my legs. This was a very easy out and back. Now, if you've been following me for a while on Strava, you know, generally speaking, I'm not an out and back kind of guy. I'm more like a loop guy, but you know, I like to mix it up once in a while. So I did an out and back. Thursday was another workout day, and this was actually my longest run of the week at 11 miles. And on that run, I warmed up for 2.5 miles. Then I did 6 miles at a tempo pace. Then I cooled down for another 2.5 miles. Give me 11 miles for the day. I have definitely found that running my long run every 2 weeks is a lot more doable for me. Ultimately, it kind of lets me take a step down week every other week. Friday, I had a busy day at work. I had to be at work very early on Friday relative to all my other days. So I chose that to take my day off. I had a good time just riding the Peloton and no running. Saturday was 7.5 miles and you know how I do, super cruisy, just going out, just enjoying the run, nice and easy, no pressure whatsoever. On Sunday, I decided to go back to the University Town Center Mall to do those hills up and down the car park. Knocked out a total of 7.6 miles that day, which was actually pretty identical to Monday. So all in all, a pretty good week. My weekly total for running was 51.78 miles, which is about 83 kilometers. And of course, I spent some time in the saddle, knocked out just under 139 miles, which is about 223 kilometers. Remember guys, let me know how your week went in the comments. Be kind, be happy, run well. See you in a couple of days.